My way. Yes, there sure you knew when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say.
Please be seated. We've gathered together this morning to remember, to thank God for, and to celebrate the life of Aubrey Raymond Green. Known to many as Aub, and of course to some as Dad or Pop. My name's Jeremy Rice. I'm the hospital chaplain at Geraldton Hospital. It's my privilege to officiate at Aub's service and my privilege to have known Aub for a small number of his nearly 94 years, and also his late and equally wonderful wife, Jewel. Aub would come as regularly as he could to the monthly service at Arcadia Waters, and it was also a privilege to talk with Aub and to pray with him at Opal Aged Care. We together want to offer our comfort and support to Ray and Denise, to David and Debbie, to Helen and Kevin, and to Wendy and Barry, and to their families, all the grandchildren and great-grandchildren. I acknowledge at the beginning that there would be different views about God, about life after death, about spirituality here, and I acknowledge and respect the freedom to hold those different views. I'm coming from a Christian perspective, and the Bible teaches that we all face our own death one day, and we give an account before God. Yet Christians believe that those who die trusting in Jesus will share eternal life with him. A verse that sums it up: God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. It's from John chapter 3, verse 16. An opening prayer. Almighty God, you love everything you have made, and you judge us with infinite mercy and justice. We rejoice in your promises of pardon, joy, and peace to all those who love you. In your mercy, turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life, and the sorrow of parting into the joy of heaven, through our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who died, rose again, and lives forevermore. Amen. So now I'm going to ask if Brady Green would come and give the eulogy for his grandfather. Thank you.
Anyone else bring two hankies today? All right. I'm so humbled to be here today. How do you sum up the life of a man like Aubrey Raymond Green in a eulogy? You simply can't, which is why we're all going to the golf club after this where they have a bar. Pop touched the lives of so many people. He was admired, he was respected, and he was loved. All the things that we would like to be. When you pass away at 93 and three quarters, you might think that most of the people who would have attended your funeral have already gone. So it's remarkable to see so many people here, and thank you all very much for travelling to spend this special day with us and celebrate his life. Born 7th of January 1927 to Henry and Mary Green, Aub was number 8 of 13 children. 5 girls and 8 boys. At 93, he was the last surviving member of the family, the end of an era. He grew up on a farm south of Cunnedon and went to school at Doodenanning, 6 miles from the farm. With all these kids in the family, it was only natural that they would get up to mischief. And sure enough, story number one. There will be a lot of stories today. The Green children went to school on a horse and sulky. One day they decided to detour to the gravel pit, where they spent the day playing and running amok. This went on for a week, until the headmaster visited and informed old Pop that the kids hadn't been to school. So Henry Green followed them the next day to discover the detour into the gravel pit, and being a strict old man, you can only imagine the trouble that they were in. Pop's school stories were hilarious. The school was small, so the students were nearly all Greens. Only 3 years ago, a friend of ours took me to the house where Pop was raised. I rang him when we were there, and Pop walked me through the house on the phone like he had just moved out. In reality, it would have been closer to 80 years ago that he lived in that house. His ability to recall so much of his life was one of the many traits that made him so special and so fortunate. It was a life with tragedy, beginning with the loss of his brother Ernie, who fell off the sulky on their way to school, through to the car accident when they were in their 60s, and that severely impacted Nan for the rest of her life. Yet it was a life filled with such highs. With his ever-expanding family, his farming ventures, and the joy he brought to all that knew him. As a young man, Pop would go shearing between the seeding and harvest seasons. He moved out of home at 20 years old, and he went share farming. Luck soon came his way, which changed his life forever. He fell off his motorbike and ended up in hospital. There he fell in love with a beautiful young nurse named Jewel Roberta Gentle. They married in 1949 and went on to have 4 children, Ray, David, Helen and Wendy. Over the years, the family have grown and Nan and Pop became grandparents to 12 and great-grandparents to 28. After 3 years of marriage, Pop and Nan bought a small farm with the guarantee of his father-in-law. 5 years later, he sold the farm to a neighbour, and away he went on a journey of buying, clearing, improving, selling, and accruing land. He did this time after time. He was never afraid of hard work. Luck may have helped Pop, but hard work made him. He then obtained a contract with the WA government to plough fire breaks along the railways with his 10-disc Sunderland Sundercut plough. Heading north from Northam to Woburn and south to Beverley, he spent 6 weeks working that job to produce enough money to buy a new red 5-ton Austin truck. Over the years, the family shifted from Cunderdon to Belcooling to Greenhills and then settled into Killarney for the next 22 wonderful years. Their final move was to Geraldton in 1990. Pop still couldn't break the habit of buying and selling land. He harvested his last crop at 83 years old. He just loved payday. And even after his retirement, which happened a few times, he loved talking about farming and he was always in touch with the seasons. He always wanted to know what was going on in Ballardew, what was going on in Southern Cross, what was going on in Esperance. It was his interest. Nanjil passed away in February 2014 and Pop missed her immensely. We all clearly recall him telling Nan that he wouldn't be far behind. His heart was broken. It was up to all his children, his grandchildren, and his great-grandchildren to take the responsibility of healing his heart and to convince him that life was still worth living. Pop's face would light up every time we would visit. You would be met with a big hello. He knew everybody's name without hesitation, from the kids right through, from his kids right through to the youngest grandies. I struggled to put names to faces, let alone as quickly as he could. Pop was as deaf as a post. And after Nan passed away, there always seemed to be some little gremlin who kept hiding his hearing aids. Be it in his pockets, in his drawers, in his washing machine, and he couldn't give a shit. It saddened me though, and I clearly remember a year or two ago when I was watching him one night sitting around the table at Mum and Dad's, Deb and Dave, Helen and Kev, Wendy and Barry. Everyone had been chatting to Pop, but as the night wore on, he simply missed so much of the laughter. The chatter got louder, and eventually he just started to hum a song. He loved his songs. He taught himself to play guitar. He would sing us songs. He would recite his favourite poetry. And it was always a beautiful insight into his earlier years. We all sat in silence when he did this. His deafness, sadly, in his later years, saw him miss out on some very entertaining family fun. Pop's life came to an end peacefully on November 20. The weeks before his passing, Pop was surrounded constantly by family members. We would like to thank the good people of St John's and the regional and the palliative care team and the staff at Opal, where they named him Mr. Hanson. A special mention also to Dr. Devine, who Pop had the utmost respect for his medical expertise and his caring nature. The last time I spoke to Pop, he put his hands in the air and he said, "I just love everyone. We love you too, mate. Rest easy."
Now I'm going to Beautiful. Now I'm going to call on Joe Angel, a friend from Killarney.
Well done, Brodie. Your pop would be very proud of you. Hi. Orb's family have asked me to reflect briefly on the time that he and Jewel brought the family to Killarney and the years they stayed. In 1968, Orb and Jewel decided to transition from small acre farming in York to broad acre farming in Killarney. Orb could see the benefit of selling higher lot cost land and buying into lower cost farming area where he could get about five or six times more land for his dollars. A pretty gutsy move considering the change was from a very reliable area to a marginal one. The family settled into our small community and York's loss became Killarney's gain. Very quickly we saw that the entire family was very community orientated and they all became a huge asset to our town. Orb's courage, love of farming and his think big attitude quickly saw his enterprise grow. Any land that became available for sale, Orb was at the front of the line doing what he loved and did better than most, negotiating and buying. During his time in Killarney, Orb and the boys acquired a very large holding of land and were respected for their ability to farm successfully on such a large scale, particularly considering the size of the machinery in those days. Ask Ray and Dave when they might finish sheeting, and there was always a bit of doubt because they weren't quite sure if Orb would find another paddock or two to put in, which he would do if the season looked pretty good. It wasn't too many years after arriving in Killarney that Orb's think big ideas made him and the boys the biggest farmers in the district, but the size of their enterprise never overtook the attitude to giving to and being a part of our community. Orb loved his sport and the social outing involved with it. He played golf and both he and Jewel played bowls in Killarney and both have their name on our bowling club honour board for various championships and positions they held within our club. Orb was a very good player, a never give an inch competitor, but as soon as the game was over, his gentlemanly, humble in victory and gracious in defeat attitude would always prevail. It was during their time in Killarney that Orb and Jewel were the innocent victims of a terrible car accident in which Jewel was so badly injured. And it was at that time that we saw another side of Orb that we hadn't known before, a caring and loving Orb. He adopted a Jewel-first attitude that was truly amazing to witness. What a wonderful carer of Jewel he was for so many years. I've mentioned Orb's big think big approach to farming and that attitude served him very well in 1974 when at our Melbourne Cup Calcutta in Killarney, Orb outbid everybody in the room to buy the racehorse Think Big in the Cup. He said he couldn't not buy the horse, could he? Think Big won the Cup that year, and when Think Big was in the Cup again the following year, Orb bought him again and Think Big won again, and has now gone down in history as one of only four horses who have ever won the Melbourne Cup multiple times. I'm not sure if Orb ever had another bet on the horses, but if he didn't, he would have to be the most successful horse punter of all time. Orb loved to sail, especially in auction. Ray and Dave would tell stories of Orb arriving home from a sale somewhere and informing them that they had a piece of machinery to go and pick up that he'd just purchased. Asked why he'd bought it, because they didn't really need it, he would tell them it was a good buy. I had the pleasure of being with Orb at a clearing sale one day and we were at the back of the crowd when bidding started. Because I could see over the top of the crowd and Orb couldn't, he asked me what was being sold and I told him it was a plough. He started sticking his hand up. He then asked, what make is it? Still bidding. I said, it's a shearer, Orb. Still sticking his hand up. He said, how many discs, Joe? I had a quick count. 24, Orb. He said, look okay? I said, yeah, looks okay, Orb. He was still going. He won the bidding. And the crowd moved forward and we went to check his purchase. I think Dave's looking for one of them, he said. I've been on the receiving end of Orb's negotiation skills as well. In 1989, the time had come to sell the land in Killarney for a move to Geraldton, and we were trying to expand at that time, and part of Orb's original farm was available for purchase. But striking a deal with Orb wasn't exactly straightforward. It featured a 4-hour standoff, 4 stand-ups to walk out, 5 cups of tea, offer versus counter-offer, fair few laughs and jokes, and finally a couple of silos of wheat and a handshake sealed the deal. Then he said with his best grin, "That was fun. Always wanted you and Robin to have that block." I was actually reading through this morning and I was looking out at the ocean and I had a thought that to Orb that particular situation would have been a bit like fishing. He knew he had me hooked, but he just wanted to play for a while before he dragged me in. It was a very sad time for Killarney when the Greens moved out, but like York's loss 22 years previously, Killarney's loss became Geraldton's gain. There seemed no age barriers with Orb. He seemed to enjoy the company of young and old alike. He enjoyed a beer, a joke, a laugh, and has earned the respect of all who knew him. He was a gentleman and a damn good bloke.
Wow. Now Gemma, I think, is coming out. Gemma Green.
Thank you, Pop. It is such a privilege to have been your granddaughter, a sentiment that I know each one of your 12 grandchildren and 28 great-grandchildren feel. I know it sounds like a cliche of the greatest kind, but honestly, it has been an honour to call you our grandfather. The satisfaction it gives also, knowing how much joy your family brought to you each and every day, is immense. You are so proud, and we are so incredibly lucky. You are admired by all, referred to as a wonderful man, a true gentleman with a unique presence, respected for your hard work and for creating your own success, but most importantly, for doing it with humility, with an open heart, and the ability to treat every person the same. You made everyone feel special, greeting us all with a warm smile, a firm handshake, a gentle hug, and a twinkle in your eyes. You embraced the good in people, speaking only kindly of others. You saw through the black and white, always seeking the good, and you forgave easily. Your emotions were real, and you were not afraid to show them. Your tears brought out the best in all of us. You appreciated the simple things, poetry, music, stories and tales, good humour, a nice meal, a cold one at the end of the day, precious family time, and good friendships. You were so happy and so positive always, never a complaint passed your lips. Songs and poems, however, you recited in abundance. Your memory for poetry was just amazing. You dressed proudly, a collared shirt, long pants and a belt, and you wore your hats so handsomely. Dressed respectfully, quietly and unassumingly, commanding respect. I would like to think that Pop has taught us that life is easier if we make good choices. He was loved by so many because he lived a good life, a beautiful man in every way, right up until his final breath. And yes, Pop loved a party. Let's do him proud and celebrate his incredible life and the legacy that he has left behind. Please speak of him often and remember all that he has taught us and hope that he's left just a little bit of himself in everyone that were fortunate enough to know him. Rest easy, Pop. Together again with your adored Nana Jewel. And I'd just like to finish, I'd like to quote the words of my 12-year-old daughter. When asked what came to mind when she thought of Pop Straubs. Lil said, "He reminds me of, you know, when you walk into a room and you don't know anyone and there's just one person that stands out? Yeah, he's that dude. He's everyone's favourite."
And now I think that son David Green, is going to come and say a few words on behalf of an old mate of Orb, Sandy. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. This is from Dad's old mate down at York, who's 95 years of age. And they are very good mates. And he sent a little letter. Orb and I went to school together at a little school at Dudenanning near York with 12 other students. This was about 90 years ago. Orb was a very good footballer. At school, he and I were unbeatable in the three-legged running races at all nearby sporting events. We were the champions at Dangeon, Dudenanning, Cunderdon, and Green Hills. What a record. In recent times, I'm not sure which foot Orb had trouble with his toes, but I can remember Orb always was on the left and I was on the right of the three-legged race. So I really hope it was his right foot. If it was his left, we would be no good at it now. Orb and I were good kids, but gee, we were rough and tumble at lunchtimes. We always looked out for one another, and more often than not, we'd end up in a punch-up with the other boys. After Orb finished school, he worked on the family farm until he branched out farming on his own in the Cunderdon area. The farm was not big enough for Orb. He sold up and bought a farm at Green Hills, and it too was not big enough. So he leased two more farms in the Green Hills area. He then sold up again and bought a farm 30 kilometres out of York on the Goldfields Road. After buying this property, he now became my neighbour. Orb had two Super 90 tractors and two big Chainman ploughs. On Saturdays, in good big open paddocks, Orb would put Ray and David on the tractors, and they were only little chaps. David was to stay at the rear, but that did not suit David, so he cut the corners till he got in front of Ray. I don't remember that. Things were good until the seasons of 1963 and 64, when we were very wet years and the crops were poor. That was enough for Orb, so he sold up and went to Clanny, where he farmed for a number of years until moving to Geraldton. Orb married a lovely girl and had a lovely family of two boys and two girls, who now have their own families and are farming successfully in Geraldton area. Orb was a very ambitious and hard-working man. Every shift Orb made was for the better, and that's why he became a very successful man. Goodbye, my old mate. We've been cobbers for 90 years, and I'll miss you very much. Thank you.
And now our granddaughter, Chloe Bradford, is going to come, I think, and read the poem, The Farmer.
He has been a farmer all his life, long before he took a wife. He knew he was meant to work the soil. His days on this earth would be spent in toil. Planting the crops and clearing the land, this was all part of the master's plan. As in his father's and grandfather's days, for generations this had been the ways, in which they would work the land and the sod, drawing nearer to nature and communing with God. To each of his neighbours he lent a hand, they worked together to farm the land. In autumn when the harvest came, each one in turn did the same. When his children were born, he watched them grow. He taught them lessons so they would know and learn the ways of the country and farm, of love, truth, respect, and to do no harm. To creature and land and those in the air, and to be good stewards of the land in their care. He watched them ride horses and float down the stream, but he knew that their future could be not his dream. This farmer, he realises that he has wealth beyond measure because here on the farm he has found all of his treasures. With his family around him, for wealth there's no need. With all of his blessings, he's a rich man indeed. His breed is a rare one. It's becoming extinct. With the world's busy lifestyle, there's no time to think. Life's becoming too hectic and people miss out on all of the beauty that lies round about. This farmer can see it as he goes through his days. From bird's nest to sunsets, each free for the gaze. The path that he's taken is a different than most. He's content in his heart and he has no need to boast. His drumbeat is different, but he follows its sounds. With his dog by his sides, he walks over this ground. Of the land that he loves, he will do it no harm. This place of his birth, the old family farm.
And now please, if you can see a screen, either the ones inside or the one outside, just above the door there, please let the photographic tribute be a springboard for your own and special memories of Aub as we listen to Slim Dusty singing, Looking Forward, Looking Back.
What does it take to keep a family together, Pop?
I can tell you in one word, love.
Looking forward, looking back. I've come a long way down the track. Got a long way left to go. Making songs from what I know. Making sense of what I've seen. All the love we've had between you and I along the track. Looking forward, looking back. There are strange days full of change on the way, but we'll be fine, unlike some. I'll be leaning forward to see what's coming. Looking forward, looking back. I've come a long way down the track. Got a long way left to go. Making songs from what I know. If I'm alone at night, I can see through all triviality of the day, and I'm okay. I just think of those who are dear to me. Looking forward, looking back. I've come a long way down the track. Got a long way left to go. Making songs from what I know. Making songs from what I know. Looking forward, looking.
Told you lately that I love you, 'cause I can't do without you anyhow. Have I told you lately how I miss you? Well, darling, I'm telling you now.
Wow. Very special.
I have a Bible reading here. It's the same one that was read at Jules' service. It's from John's Gospel, chapter 14, the first six verses. Jesus is recorded as saying to his friends, his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas, that's doubting Thomas, said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Here ends the reading. So today we gather to give thanks for Aub's amazing life. I think I have first had the privilege of meeting Aub when visiting Jewel when she was unwell in St. John of God Hospital. Some have known and loved Aub their whole lives. Today we give thanks for the time that Aub shared with us, and also for the eternal life that is our hope in Jesus Christ. Our Bible reading today touches on so many of the feelings that may be being felt by some of you here now, especially family. Jesus talks about finding peace for troubled hearts, about trusting God the Father and in himself, God the Son, and about the way home. Jesus, on the night before he died, so the night before Good Friday, is saying goodbye to his special friends, an opportunity we would all like to have before we go. It was too soon for the disciples. They weren't ready. They were unsettled. They were sad. They were anxious. However, they understand that for some reason, Jesus will have to go away and it's not something they want to hear. Their hearts are troubled. Why all this talk of leaving? How will they cope without him? And Jesus tells his friends not to be afraid. He can understand their anxiety, but he wants them to be reassured. His word to them is his word to us all. It's there in the Bible. They're anxious in their loss, they're sad. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. And with that encouragement, Jesus reminds them and us to have faith. Faith in God, faith in him. Real faith lifts our spirits with the reminder that even when facing loss, there is still nothing of which to be afraid. In your hour of trouble, more than ever, believe in God. Believe there is a God, that you are never alone with your anxieties, that you never simply have to manage things on your own, but you can go to him as a loving father. And even when you forget him, he's there seeking you out, because that's what he does. If we would but turn to him in faith and love, like a prodigal son or daughter. Jesus has shown his disciples what a life of complete trust in God looks like after they'd spent 3 years with him. And now he's going to take the lesson to a whole new level with his journey to the cross. A moment earlier, Jesus had said, "Where I'm going, you cannot follow now, but you will follow later." Some of you will have been taught from childhood what his journey to the cross was like. Jesus knows pain and suffering. He can help you. And on the cross, the Bible tells us, he died to take in his body, in his soul, in his spirit, the penalty for our sins. And on the third day, he rose again, job done. If your belief in God needs to be strengthened, you'll find all the strength you need in Jesus. We can be sure he is strong when we're weak and that he knows what he's talking about. So I'd ask you respectfully, do you have room in your heart to believe, in your mind to believe these words? Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. At one time, a time known only to God in our future, Jesus says he'll come back and take all who have faith in him to be with him for eternity, that where I am, you may be also. Through Jesus Christ, we have a home. We can have a home. In our Father's house, his Father's house. Jesus called heaven his Father's house. Home. Home is a place of love, forgiveness, where people wait for you with open arms. This is the place that Jesus has prepared for us, a home in the embrace of his Heavenly Father, our Heavenly Father. In our Bible reading today, and I've nearly finished, Jesus is showing us how to say goodbye, at least for now. Not all of us want to say goodbye. He said, "You know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas didn't. "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So we could say that the way home is not so much of where to go, but who you know. Today we say goodbye to Aub, and our hope is through faith in Jesus. He is at home with Jewel and all the faithful departed, and our Lord Jesus Christ in his Father's house. That's what Jesus makes possible for all of us. So can I finish by urging you to consider a living faith, if you don't have one already, in Jesus Christ. Trust in God, trust also in Jesus. Know God's peace, know God's hope, and a place in God's house, and know the way, God's Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for listening. Help us, O God, to receive and understand your good news, so that we may find light in our darkness, strength in our grief, and hope and comfort in your saving works. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And prayers thanking God for Aub's life and asking for comfort and strength for family and close friends. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of life. You made us in your own image. And today we especially want to thank you for Aub's life, remembering his love for his family, his many, many skills, his hard work, his courage, his honesty, his straight dealing, his faith, his humour, and his memory. And we thank you for all the memories that death cannot take away. Merciful God, we pray for Aub's family and close friends when we cannot understand the things that happen, when we're weighed down with grief and loneliness. Lift us up in your love. Give us the assurance of your constant care, that we may have courage for the days ahead. Through Jesus Christ, Lord, Saviour, and Shepherd. Amen. I'm going to pray the Lord's Prayer now. If you wanted to join in, either in your hearts or out loud, please do so in whatever version you might remember. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. On behalf of the family, can I give you all an invitation to accompany them in just a couple of minutes to the graveside for the brief committal service there? And following that service, to join them for lunch and refreshments at the Geraldton Golf Club in Pass Street, where there'll be lots of opportunities for sharing more stories, more wonderful stories of Aub. I'll close with a blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to have a closing song now, and Aub's casket will be carried to the waiting hearse, the waiting vehicle, for that journey to the graveside. So could I ask you now if you could, if you were able, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, to stand. Please do so. Thank you.
Come this far, down through the years, to where we are, side by side. the sea in search of freedom. I till the soil for seed to grow. I build the fences to hold the cattle. I mine the earth in search of gold. I shear the sheep.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of a storm, there's a golden sky and the sweet silver song of love. Walk on.
I'll press on. Thank you for gathering here at Orb's graveside. Beautiful balloons, by the way, children. I don't know if the children are still here, but that was well done. Nice colours, yellow and blue, eagles. I'll read from Psalm 103 in the Bible. You, O Lord, are full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and of great goodness. As a father cares for his children, so is your care for those who fear you. For you know of what we are made. You remember that we are but dust. Our days are like grass. We flourish like a flower of the field. When the wind goes over it, it is gone, and its place will know it no more. But your loving kindness, O Lord, endures forever and ever on those that fear you, and your righteousness on their children's children. I'll pray the committal prayer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life. In your keeping are all who have departed in Christ. We here commit the body of our dear brother Aubrey to be buried in the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who died and was buried and rose again for us, and who shall change our mortal body that it may be like his glorious body. Thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God of all consolation, in your unending love and mercy for us, you turned the darkness of death into the dawn of new life. Be our refuge and strength in sorrow, as your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by dying for us, conquered death, and by rising again, restored us to life. So may we go forward in faith to meet him, and after our life on earth, be united with our dear brothers and sisters in Christ, where every tear will be wiped away. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Just before a final blessing, could I repeat the invitation on behalf of the family to everyone, if you're able, to join them after this service for lunch and refreshments, and to continue sharing memories of Orb at the Geraldton Golf Club. A prayer of blessing. Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this trouble-filled life, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes. The busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the Lord, at the last, through Christ our Lord. Amen. As specially chosen songs are played, starting with What a Wonderful World, there'll be the opportunity to follow the family in laying some heads of wheat, placing them into the grave so that they fall on the lid of Orb's casket. Thank you. The casket will now be lowered.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do. They're really saying I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They're like much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Walked in fields of gold.